Bibles to the New Testament, to Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 27. Ephesians 5 and verse 27. Herein the great apostle Paul writes the church at Ephesus. And while there are many things in this chapter, the emphasis I want us to take note of here is about the Lord's church. Verse 27 reads that he might present it, that's the church, to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. One does not have to know all of the biblical languages to hear the simplicity and yet the beauty of those words and the meanings of them. It's clear that the church is a very important institution planned out in the mind of God. And yet, even as inspiration was in men and the New Testament was being written, there were great problems in the church. We all know that the church of our Lord was established on the first Pentecost after the resurrection of Christ, as Luke records in Acts chapter 2. If we're familiar at all with what the Bible teaches about the church, we all know it was purchased when the Lord shed his blood on Calvary's cross, Acts 20 and verse 28. We often say in preaching about the church that surely the church was worth the purchase price. And to denigrate the church as having nothing to do with man's salvation and to belittle it and make light of it is also to make light of the purchase price of the church. It's saying the Lord really didn't know what he was doing when he shed his blood to purchase the church. People rarely think that way because they do not think of the church as it is revealed on the pages of the New Testament. For hundreds of years now, since the Protestant Reformation, in Europe, men have thought of the church fundamentally from the denominational viewpoint. But if you go back to the first century and specifically the inspired writings of the New Testament, you never see that concept that there's one great invisible body of Christ made up of various churches with different names, different ideas, different approaches to various things. That concept's not in your Bible. And if you think that it is, then I simply say go back and read your Bible. If you believe it to be the Word of God, it'll make it clear that it's not. You might ask, well, where did the denominational concept of the church come from? Well, also in the New Testament, there's warnings of a great apostasy. And we find out from secular history that the church began to change considerably. Within 100 or so years of its establishment, that various schisms and all sorts of false doctrines were being preached for several hundred years following the first century. But there never was a concept, as far as the church is concerned, even in the midst of all of those false doctrines, a time of great apostasy. But there was but one single solitary church. Growing out of that apostasy developed the Roman Catholic Church. The Roman Catholic Church was never a part of the Church of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. My brethren, many gospel preachers also many times will refer to the Roman Catholic Church as an apostate church. Well, now, if you're apostate, you had once be the church. If you're an unfaithful child of God, you had at one time be faithful. The Roman Catholic Church developed out of the apostate church. But even then, there was the concept of one single solitary institution containing all the saved of the earth. Then, with all of the hundreds or thousand years of corruption that multiplied within Roman Catholicism, always it continued to say, we are the church. There is but one church, meaning there is but one institution wherein God has all the saved, regardless of how corrupted they were. But the Protestant Reformation started even in the 1500s, sometime a little earlier, but really 1600s was when it reached its peak. Protestant, meaning they protested. Protested what? The corruptions in the Roman Catholic Church. Very rich time to study church history. But nevertheless, that's when a concept came up called denominationalism. Protestant denominationalism. Because you had what has been called today the mainline denominations starting. Church of England, Presbyterianism, and so on. They rebelled against the meritorious works of Roman Catholicism. And as so many times, sadly to say, is the situation, they ran to the other extreme. Roman Catholicism says the more works you do, the more you're going to be able to have a hope of heaven. It makes all sorts of promises. It's all based upon how many times you do something. Luther and others declared no, salvation is by faith only. Well, that's going too far the other direction. The New Testament nowhere teaches salvation is by faith only. Or anything else only. It doesn't even teach baptism only saves. It doesn't teach that repentance only saves. It doesn't teach that confessing Christ as Savior only saves. That a lot of people don't understand, and many members of the church don't understand. And what I've said thus far, there are a great many members of the church today who would agree more with the denominational false concept of the church than they would with what the New Testament of the Christ teaches about the church. Now, we just sang a song a moment ago. I didn't know Mark was going to sing it, but it's great that he did. Holy Bible, book divine, precious treasure, thou art mine. Precious treasure, thou art mine. How much time do we spend with it? And a great many sermons are preached on various texts of the Scriptures, or those texts are completely ignored, trying to teach that they don't mean what they say. Or we just don't bring this up because of false doctrine. Well, then, denominationalism and that false concept of the church has held sway for 500 years thereabouts over the people and their concept of New Testament Christianity, which it is not. When you look at 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 10, Paul begs the church, even while writing part of the New Testament, the church at Corinth, now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, it's by His authority this apostle is writing, and beseech means I'm begging you, that you all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, and that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. If that were the only scripture in the whole New Testament, it's obviously clear that no church that promotes division in things pertaining to salvation and living the Christian life and what the Bible actually teaches about the church cannot be right. If a church is going to be what the Lord wants it to be, it's going to uphold the truths of 1 Corinthians 1:10. The church you read of in the Bible was established by Christ, built by Christ, Matthew 16, 18, purchased by the blood of Christ, as we said, Acts 20 and 28. But the thing that we need to note, and we read about it in Ephesians 5 in the beginning, is that the Bible presents plainly that the church is a divine institution, although it is comprised of fallible human beings. We should, in fact, we must always keep in mind that the church has both a human side and a divine side. The divine side, the church and the wisdom of Almighty God, is absolutely perfect. It is flawless. It doesn't need anything added to it or altered or taken away from it. But the human side, the church being composed of individual human members, is imperfect and subject to mistakes, because humans are subject to mistakes. If that wasn't the case, if it was all just on the divine side of things, then there would have been a falling away. Even while the New Testament was being written, how far do you read into any one of the epistles that the divine writer is not addressing some problem among the brethren? You just don't have to read very far at all. The human side of the church is made just as clear in the teaching of the New Testament as is the divine side. Now, what does that do for you and me? Before you become a member, if you're considering the gospel and what it really means and its demands on your life and what it means to be converted to Christ, or after you have from the heart obeyed the gospel and you're a member of the church, what does that do for me? How does that help me live a faithful Christian life? Well, first of all, it tells me what to expect in the church. I'm always amazed after over 50 years of preaching to find some members of the church and they act like they're completely surprised that members of the church make mistakes. That members of the church are at different degrees of knowledge of the Bible and different strengths of faith. And that members of the church can totally apostatize. Do they ever read their Bibles? This holy Bible, book divine, precious treasure, thou art mine. Lamp to my feet and a light to my way to guide me safely home. Have they failed in understanding what the Bible teaches about the divine side and then the human side? I think it is extremely great and good that the Holy Spirit-inspired writers of the Bible did not conceal errors and mistakes of the members of the church while the New Testament was being written. For if we, after having that information, can conclude some of the things we do and act totally surprised about members of the church pulling some terrible stunts, then what would it have been if they hadn't told us during the time of its writing that there were people who did that and part of the New Testament was written to correct people who were members of the church and yet had gone astray? You might try this sometimes in your study, just in a casual reading of the New Testament, as it is in truth the will of Christ. During the lives of inspired men, while the New Testament was being written, and some of the reason that it was written, you find the problem of division. Again, I read you that, 1 Corinthians. That church was in terrible state of division. You read of members of the church engaged in immorality, 1 Corinthians 5:1, and others who are not engaged in it were pretty pleased about it. Paul says they were puffed up. Nobody getting upset about members of the church living like the world. Again, in that same letter, in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 12, they had some there even teaching the false doctrine that the resurrection is past already. And you just simply read through the New Testament and you'll see a great many other false doctrines that the apostles and other inspired writers had to meet in those letters. And I may say here that in God's infinite wisdom, the New Testament and the Bible in general has anticipated every error that will ever arise in the whole world. And if we study it and rightly divide it and live by it, then it forearms us because it forewarns us. And we're not caught in the lurch, as it were, or surprised by what men do. Paul addressed in the second letter to the church in Thessalonica, chapter 3 and verse 6, those who were engaged in disorderly conduct. They were not conducting their lives in an orderly fashion as the New Testament taught them to. I don't know what all was involved, but I do know it was out of harmony with the order the New Testament teaches. James, in James 3 and verse 14, address brethren because of their strife between each other and the envy they had with one another and the use of the tongue. Just people being people, but evidencing they're really not converted as they ought to be. All of these are addressing worldliness in members of the church. You know, the church can't go wrong if the people don't go wrong, because the church is people. There's even the sin of being a busybody or a meddler in other men's matters. Well, you know, some things were not private to the person, and God permitted him to have his own business. There was nobody else's business. Then this wouldn't make any sense. But have you ever noticed that the particular prominent movies and television sitcoms and things all involve the juicy stuff each person finds out about the other and then does something with it that really is none of his business? In fact, how often do you hear in today's society this comment, "That's none of your business"? Now, if you haven't thought about that, I want you to notice it rarely comes up that somebody says to somebody or bodies, "That's none of your business." But yet here is one of those sins. People being a busybody or a meddler in other men's matters, 1 Peter 4:15 and 2 Thessalonians 3:11. Well, if we didn't know that such sins existed in the Lord's church, even while the New Testament of the Christ was being written, addressing these sins in the early church, if we didn't know that existed even from the beginning, then in view of how we operate anyway, how discouraged and weary would we find ourselves today? I don't know what people get out of the reading of the Bible. Do they never read that these things were in the church? The Lord didn't condone them. He rebuked them. He told people committing them to straighten up. But why do we think that only happened 2,000 years ago in the church, but it can't happen today? Why do we think it's so? It's amazing at what really we allow, that is, we permit, to get us down in the dumps, to get us discouraged. And I hate to say this, but I'm afraid it's true. Really showing where our faith is located, and it's not in Jesus Christ. Human nature hasn't changed. We're all just like those folks. Technologies change, language change, etc. But we're all the same folks. The same thing that motivated them motivates us. And that's why the Bible is such an up-to-date book. It's always fresh to every generation. And through a study of the Scriptures, we can see the same weaknesses, the same problems that trouble members of the church today and cause problems in the churches. I need to be asking myself the question, in all honesty, is my conduct as a member of the Lord's church causing trouble for my Lord and for my brethren? Or is it edifying the church? And that's going to go back to what I've said much about lately, is your attitude toward your own brethren. Do you really love them? Do you really care about them? The early church had its troublemakers, and it would do us good to study them and to study their characteristics and more that the Bible has to say about them. Think of Diotrephes. In 3 John 9, John speaks of him as one who loves to have the preeminence. Is there nobody in the world today that loves to have the preeminence among other people? Even in the church? Unfortunately, the tribe of Diotrephes is still with us. I've always found this, as other preachers and members of the church have, found the following to be rather amusing, to put it mildly, that many elders think that Diotrephes was a preacher, and many preachers think that he was one of the elders. But it really doesn't matter. Preacher, elder, who else he might have been, he possessed a character trait that spelled trouble for the Lord's church. He loved to have the preeminence. He loved to be number one. And he loved to have his way. And he was going to. Now, what has always bothered me more about this is that, you know, you can't have one purpose, one person ruling over a church that he loves to have preeminence over all those people, having his own way all the time, as John described him. Except that the people have been taught and that they believe he ought to have that power. Evidently he did, and evidently they did. He always wanted to be in the chief position. John simply said he prated against us with malicious words. That is, against the apostles of Christ, in order to keep his power of preeminence in that church. And if you work at the church as long as I have, I've found it not to be an uncommon thing to find Diotrephes of various levels of this preeminent disease still around in the church today. You can see it even in homes. It's just simply a person that says, I'll have my way. Or as one man serving as an elder told me one time in the whole church, when he didn't get his way, quote, I should come down there and just tear the whole place up, unquote. Now, he really was qualified to serve as an elder. Well, he wasn't even qualified to be a Christian with that attitude. Then you go a little further and you come across a couple of women, Euodias and Syntyche. As one preacher said, old Euodias and Syntyche. These were women in the church at Philippi, and that church had a relationship with Paul that was amazing. He loved them greatly, and they had supported him when others wouldn't. Yet Paul had to write in a letter to the church and single out these two ladies and said much what he said to the whole church at Corinth, that they ought to be of the same mind in the Lord, Philippians 4:2. Now, let me ask you something. How are you the same mind in the Lord? Well, if it's not by following exactly the authoritative word of the New Testament, I don't know how. He spoke of these women as women which labored with me in the gospel. They weren't so worldly. They weren't involved in that kind of thing. They labored with him in the gospel. He appreciated their work. They had been workers with the great apostle Paul in the gospel, assisting him, no doubt. But they fell into some kind of disagreement. We're not told the nature of that disagreement. It really doesn't make any difference, because if they had the right attitude toward God and toward living the Christian life, they would have recognized they could settle this matter. And how would they have done it? Being the same mind in the Lord, letting the Bible settle the matter between them. So today there are going to be personal disagreements. Don't think there won't be. There will be. And yet, many times they can adversely impact the rest of the members. They can hurt the church. A lot of things we let bother us, we permit them to bother us. There are some things we ought to be like the old brother told me in my first full-time work. He said, I just got a hole right here that goes right out through here. And there's a lot of things my brethren say and do. It just never takes up residence in here. It goes in, it goes right out, and I go on about my business. How many times have brethren harbored thoughts, laid awake at night? It was on their mind, even on the job, to where they couldn't think straight, about some personal slight. At least they took it that way. That somebody made against them. God never intended any such thing. And sometimes we magnify those things when they weren't meant to be that way. But we just know they meant that at me. I promise you, as surely as I stand here and you look at me, if you're going to be a faithful gospel preacher for any length of time at all, you've got to learn to adopt that hole in the head. Because it's going to bother you. Because there will be those people who will say things to you specifically to cut you down. And a whole lot more said behind your back that you don't hear of. In time, you learn to deal with that kind of thing. Well, they're hurting themselves and they do it. They're evidencing their own lack of Christian character. But of course, we move on from Diotrephes, Euodias, and Syntyche. And we come to that wonderful married couple we know as Ananias and Sapphira. You know, if we didn't have God intervening, since he knows the hearts of all men, revealing it to Peter, you might never know these people really like they were. How could you? They gave to the Lord's church. They may have been involved in about anything there. It sounds like, by what they did in the matter of their giving, that they were involved. But it's not the giving. It's that they lied about their gift in order to gain the praise of men. Acts chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. What they're doing is placing personal ambition and pride above the cause of Christ. And you know, they agreed together and they didn't hesitate to lie even to fulfill their very self-willed and selfish desires. They were Jewish converts. They knew better than this if they lived like they ought to under the Old Testament. How often does the Old Testament and the Ten Commandments forbid lying? So what does this say? Colossians 3:9, Paul plainly stated, lie not one to another. And you see how God thought about that as to those church troublers, because he killed both of them. As a forewarning to all of us of what's finally going to happen on the great day of judgment if we pursue such kind of living. Then, of course, we come across a fellow by the name of Demas. What an example he is. And he was a good example if you just read part of what the Bible has said about him. He accompanied Paul in his labors. But he had one big problem. He loved the world more than he did the work of the church. And he forsook Paul when he was most needed, because Paul just says it to Timothy. He loved this present age or world, 2 Timothy 4:10. Now, I don't think this means that we should assume that he became an adulterer, fornicator, went back to idolatry. To follow Paul around and to be what Paul was meant a great deal of suffering. No one likes to be knocked in the head when you're trying to save souls and teaching people the gospel. Well, Paul suffered a lot of that kind of thing. The privation that he underwent, the constant fear and the loneliness among men. I can see pretty quickly why somebody would like to go to where that just wasn't such of a problem. And evidently, he did. That is Demas. In Colossians 4:14, Paul mentioned him as a companion. The church is in this world. We, members of the church, are in this world. Tomorrow we'll be all over the place around this area, jobbing in school and associated for the most part with a lot of people that don't care one thing in the world about the gospel of the church. But the church is not to be like the world. That is, each member of the church, wherever you are tomorrow, if God allows time to continue, you're to be different from the world because you think differently, you live differently, because you follow the teaching of the Bible. But the worldly-minded weaken the church, and they expose it to an open shame. And I must needs then ask the question, are we looking for an easy route like Demas? Oh, you can still assemble like we are now and in a free society like we have. You can do all, but really, are you trying at every opportunity to teach the truth to people, even though you might have to cease becoming their friend? Are you always looking for that opportunity to have an inroad in to present the gospel? Or are you trying to say, I've got to be quiet about that here to this person? The devil works, but he always works to destroy us. The last couple I want to notice are Hymenaeus and Philetus. These fellows not only taught false doctrine concerning the resurrection, but Paul places a lot of what they taught as profane and vain babbling, 2 Timothy 2:16 through 17. They were talking foolishly. They talked as fools. That's how Webster defines babbling. They talked without knowing what they were talking about. I don't know what possesses people to do that, but they do it. You ever been around somebody, no matter what story you tell, immediately they're going to tell one bigger than one you told? Well, they're out there. If you haven't met them, just keep on. You'll find them. Paul said, shun such people. Stay away from them. Don't be where they can influence you. Don't company with them. These fellows wrought havoc in the Lord's church because of their babbling. I've said in Bible classes where somebody always had to open their mouth and say something, no matter whether they knew about what they were talking about or not. There have been some who would say something because they had a particular false doctrine they wanted to press. But that's sort of characteristic of Diotrephes. You can't want to have the preeminence among people unless you prove yourself to be somebody that appears at least to know about everything about everything. Well, now here are these troublemakers. They're in your Bible. You can read about them. Why did God put them there? And what are you supposed to learn from them? How do they help you be faithful today in the church? To any of you who may not be members of the Lord's church, do you see that there are going to be people like that in the church? No matter how humble you are, no matter how repentant, no matter how much you believe in Christ, and how much you desire to obey the gospel, and from the heart you're baptized to Christ for the remission of sins, these people are going to show up. Do you remember that it was Paul who made this statement when he wrote to the Corinthians that there must needs be heresies coming in the church? Because that's the way the faithful are revealed. Have you seen the attitude of the age today? Let's just go along, get along. That's where we are. You believe what you want to. I'll believe what I want to. Totally different. But let's not make a big stir over it. Well, you breed a bunch of folks like that, have no conviction over anything except getting their own way. I've never seen somebody feel that way about their own selfish desires. They want that. And they'll fight you over that. They'll cause trouble in the church over that, when they won't be that concerned about it, thus saith the Lord. If you're going to become a Christian, you need to be aware. You need to be vaccinated with these truths from God's hypodermic needle. That when these things come up, you're not surprised. You're not home wringing your hands saying, I can't believe that person claims to be a member of the church and does that kind of thing. Why can't you? The Bible forewarned you. It told you about those people, even when the apostles walked this earth, would lie right to an apostle in the days of miracles. How much more so today? So you see, there's a great work to do. Spread the gospel to every creature, to all those that don't know it. But then to keep the church like the Bible says the church ought to be, pure and a precious thing in His sight, without wrinkle. That's our job as faithful members, in whatever capacity we have, is to keep the church pure. And that means dealing with members who aren't pure, because they choose to be not pure and follow their own ways, whether it's like these here. And wouldn't you think those are in the Bible to show us some of the ways they're going to be and what you're going to have to deal with? If it's not, will you please sit down when you go home today and say, I don't know why these are in the Bible. They teach me nothing. The only problem with that is that's going to say more about you than it does the Bible. So whether you're a Christian and you're thinking about becoming a Christian, and we urge you to become a Christian, because you're without salvation unless you're a member of the church Jesus built. Because those on the Pentecost, when it started, heard the gospel, believed it, repented of their sins, confessed their faith in Christ, and they were baptized for the remission of sins. It's the only way you become a Christian, Acts 2:38. The Lord added them to His church. And then you have the rest of the New Testament telling you about a lot of those folks that were baptized, how they turned out. But you also have people like Peter, and we'll close on this note. Peter sinned. Paul was stood into the face. Galatians tells us about this. And all the evidence is he humbly repented. If anybody ever had a right to be feeling he was preeminent over anybody else, it would have been a man of Peter's background, but he didn't. So there can be those who step off into a mess by their own choice, poor choice though it was. And if you'll do what you're supposed to do as a faithful child of God, as Paul did, you'll be standing to the face and point out that he's made the wrong choice. He needs to change. We all can repent, whether we will or not, it's another story. But we will if our sorrow toward God for our sins against Him will mount strongly enough, it'll move us to repent. And then we'll confess our sins and pray God for forgiveness. And God will forgive us. Isn't that amazing? But if you're not a child of God, you see that there's only one way. The plan of salvation. Believe in Christ, repent of your sins, confess your faith in Him, and be baptized for the remission of sins. That's the way that's right and cannot be wrong. And if you'll be faithful to the Lord in His church, you'll go to heaven. It's just that simple. But you've got to have a resolve on your part based upon the truth of the Bible that you're going to be stubborn with the truth and first of all applying it to your own life and then applying it to everybody else with great love for God, His Word, and the dear brethren of the church. If you're subject to the great gospel invitation, we invite you to come while we stand and sing.